I had found a YouTube video of an unknown Quake 2 mod attributed to Duke Media, recammed by the Immortal. For years, I tried and failed to get answers, piling up month after month of unanswered questions on gaming forums and discussion groups. Nobody had seen or heard of this Quake 2 mod before. Was it really possible that this video was all that remained of an unknown Quake 2 mod? The breakthrough came when I got in touch with Peter Duke, who had founded Duke Media in the late 90s. Peter Duke was one of the lead designers for GameWorks, the adult arcade created by Sega and DreamWorks that first opened in Seattle in 1997. Peter Duke says, "Yes, I was in Seattle for the opening. All of my work on Spectator video games was because Steven Spielberg made it a priority. The whole thing started because Spielberg saw all the video monitors in GameWorks and asked, 'What are you going to play on those?' The answer, music videos, didn't satisfy him. He said, 'You have to make video games that people want to watch, like sports.' My boss turned to me and said, 'Now you know what your job is.'"
Hidden keep, a leap not taken. Retrace your steps, escape your past, and the key will be yours at last.
This is the Oasis, a whole virtual universe. You can do anything, be anyone, without going anywhere at all.
Sega will continue to lead the arcade industry with the openings of GameWorks in Seattle, a 30,000 square foot arcade mecca. Spearheaded by Steven Spielberg, GameWorks will combine the hottest virtual reality games in the world with elements of the classic arcade.
Like you see, we have the Indy 500 and we have other simulator rides, we have virtual reality.
Gamers can be totally immersed in a true interactive environment, from a high-speed orbiting F-14 flight simulator to battling up to four opponents in a high-impact tank command game, where the player feels every shot and hit of his or her tank.
The Indy 500 ride is an eight-player simulator, $3 per person a ride. They race against each other. It is run on hydraulics. The cars move, they crash, they tumble over. It's a lot of fun, completely interactive, and most people that come off love it.
Congratulations there, ladies and gentlemen, and thank you for racing on Indy 500.
It's great, real fun, recommend it to anybody.
Well, one of our signature mottos right now at our corporation is get out of the house. That's the new Sega GameWorks motto. And that's what we would like to see people get out of the house, get out with their family, friends, boyfriends, girlfriends, come on out, try video games, and just to have the whole game room experience with the new technology that's out.
The ultimate place to play games with friends.
I think one of the interesting concepts about this place is it's a wonderful marriage of low and high tech.
What we wanted to build was this game factory that had been around
for a long, long time. So we invented this general gaming company. And GameWorks is actually in that company's factory. You'll notice that as you walk around GameWorks, you walk from one environment to another, and it's like a musical crossfade. This room has its own sound, its own light level, and its own mix of games, and that creates kind of a vibe, kind of an energy level there.
In the arena, we are featuring signature games. They're almost like rides that operate like video games.
It's a place that I think you'll hear a lot of applause. You know, as you walk in the door, you'll hear people cheering for each other and yelling and laughing. The area is about competition. There's a balcony area that you can stand and watch people play. It's where the latest games are introduced to the world. We have the ability to take the highest score in the room and use the projector in the ceiling to display the face of the hottest player in the room.
It's a place for you to go up to the internet lounge where you can get game tips and then hopefully relax for a second and then go back down and fight.
It's a place where you can go do something constructive. Instead of blowing something up, you can find somebody to talk to.
That was Peter Duke, who would go on to be involved in the Quake Arcade Edition. In 1997, Peter Duke, with Clan Ring founder Frank Kabansky, organized the Red Annihilation Tournament, which culminated in a final held at E3 with a Quake tournament, and the winner would receive John Carmack's Ferrari. Dennis Thresh Fong would go on to win.
Thresh versus Entropy from Red Annihilation 1997 was going to go home with his Ferrari. Commentary by the commish.
Frank the commish Kabansky and his partner Peter Duke built upon their experience running popular Quake tournaments and began developing for Game Arc, an 8-player arcade cabinet custom built for death matching at Sega Gameworks.
We have great home systems, we can rent a videotape, we have cable, but for some reason people still want to have that theatrical experience. GameArc will do that to gaming, what movie theaters did to movies.
You sit in a chair that has surround sound built into it. There's vibration built into the seat. It moves a little bit. You have the coolest controller there is, and an 8-foot-wide projection screen that actually wraps around the viewer. The kind of hook for that is that it's 8 players that are very, very well connected together. So you're playing against your friends right there in the same room.
8-player Quake 2 on GameArc featured a new level built on HIP DM1 by Richard Level Lord Gray. Inspired by Steven Spielberg's vision of a spectator-worthy Quake 2, Frank Kabansky and Peter Duke together programmed this Quake 2 mod playable on the 8-person GameArc cabinet.
When you walk through the door, I want you to be amazed. I want you to realize that there's a destination here, that you have landed.
Hello everyone, I'm Vince McMahon.
And I'm good old JR.
We have a great match for our fans tonight. The revolutionary force in sports entertainment.
Fun to watch.
It's hammered
him out big time.
How's that butt-kicking feel, punk?
Imagine what it would be like playing Quake 2 in one of those cabinets with an 8-foot wraparound screen, and then you take out your rocket launcher and rocket jump.
The object is to find your friends and blow holes in them with your weaponry.
You've got a room full of people that are playing the same game, and it gets really noisy. I mean, people screaming at each other, and we want that rowdy feeling to happen around GameWorks. That's what that game is about.
It'd be something that you can go to GameWorks and actually see the very best technology that's out there on GameWorks.
I am Frank Kabansky, the grandfather of competitive video games and the person who produced the mod and maps featured in this video. I was, along with William Bryant, an admin and organizer for a clan team organization, Clan Ring, that was officially sponsored by id Software. We organized and operated official events for id, including QuakeCon, as well as our own id-endorsed tournaments and leagues. Id and Activision had shut down the idea for similar use of even their own logos in custom maps I produced for the Red Annihilation tournament. That's the tournament that gave away John Carmack's Ferrari to a Quake player, Thresh Dennis Fong. The custom maps made for Red Annihilation had Id, Activision, and other sponsor logos, but at the last minute, Id decided they didn't want corporate logos in the maps. This was created for the Quake TV concept, and the use of the Activision and id logos were with permission. We, Peter Duke and I, met with those companies to discuss this concept, and their reaction was, go for it. The permission was only for use in pitches, although we did have a verbal framework for licensing the game for the project if it went live. The mod was not, at the time, available to the public. We only used it to create video and to pitch the concept to networks and studios. That's why you won't find much info about it. I am Peter Duke. Frank and I met because Steven Spielberg told my team at GameWorks that we had to develop video games that people want to watch. Frank produced the original Quake TV mod. I was already working with id on a project that I programmed as a producer, not a coder, called Game Arc. That was the first multiplayer online game that included video of all of the players in-game in 1996-1997. I also designed the arcade controls for the arcade version of Quake with another third-party partner. Anyway, I met Frank, and we started working on it under the auspices of Spielberg GameWorks, and then investor support for GameWorks collapsed. Our design department went from 300 to 16. I was one of the last to go. But Frank and I still thought it was a good idea, and we pitched it to as many people as would listen. We made a lot of presentations, reworked the ideas over and over again, but in the end, we were just early. Spectator gaming is a real thing now, but it still hasn't touched many of the concepts that Frank and I knew were necessary to make it really popular. Pro gaming still doesn't really completely understand show business.
Alright, all you video game heads, and right now I'm at Game Arc. It's like an 8-player, multi-spectacular video game, and Will Smith is checking it out. What do you think about it?
Man, this is hot. See, like, what it is, I'm playing against all these other guys, right? But they're a little better than me, that's why they keep killing me. You know, but I'm about to get real good at it. But like, as you can see, you know, we're inside of these tunnels, and you know, it's not unlike a movie. You know, it's like you're in the middle of a movie fighting a lot of guys for some stuff.
Well, speaking of that, don't you got a movie coming out where you're fighting aliens like this?
Yeah, it's called Men in Black, July 2nd. See, it's not like Independence Day. It's very different. This movie's a comedy with myself and Tommy Lee Jones. We're the Men in Black. We get to do a lot of shooting and jumping and stuff. Hey, it's the big movie of the summer.
We have a whole generation now of adults, of grown-ups that are out kind of beginning to run the world
that have never known a world that wasn't filled with video games.
In order to imagine how awesome it would be to play Quake 2 in an 8-person arcade cabinet, I found it helpful to look at some of the games developed specifically for GameWorks launch, including the Indy 500 racing game and the Vertical Reality elevator shooter.
We've got a celebrity race like you have never seen before. We're on the Indy 500. We've got 8 celebrities stocked up, big stars and little cars. It's going to be good. I can tell you who everyone is, but basically it's Will Smith and a bunch of his white friends. This is going to be a slaughterhouse. Gentlemen, start your engines! Okay, we got Will Smith in car one. He's our favorite tonight. He's a video game freak. And there go the cars, jiggle jiggle. We've got that. There are amazing songsters tonight, ripping it up. Will Gates in car four, gonna want to watch out for him, guys. He's pretty crafty, they say. We've got a swinger in first place over there in car number six. He's doing pretty good. I believe we got a Weird Al down there in second place, taking up the top two spots. Oh! That's not true. Just dropped out. Katzenberg in car number three. I don't know if it's the car shaking or if it's him. Weird Al holding down a solid first place. Sean Kenny from Alice in Chains in lane five. He's in third place. Make that fourth place. I'm sorry. I cannot beat the results quick enough. The cars are going so fast. Scale speeds of about 400 miles an hour here tonight.
It doesn't even matter that I lost the Indy 500. I've already achieved my dream in life of kicking Bill Gates' butt in a car race. So
not bad, not bad. I got to show you guys this game behind me, Vertical Reality. I can't tell you about it. Watch this.
You've got to sit down in your Vertical Reality chair. You've got to grab onto the joystick. And you've got to defend your world against these evil machines that are taking things over. In this game, levels are truly physical levels. The computer moves you up, and you keep going until the final level at the very top. The best player, if he's really good, will be playing directly against Mr. Big. And if you are not a really excellent player, you're going to get blown up. And when you get blown up here, you actually fall, and you can fall 25 feet. And it's pretty funny, not knowing when it's going to come, it's kind of scary.
John and Steven give their inputs and ask all the right questions. You know, a guy like Steven, if he looks at it, he likes it. You know, we can do whatever we want with it.
John Snoddy came to me one day and said, what do you think it would be like to drop 24 feet in a chair? And we went to this company and they had a chair on a stick. We shot him 24 feet into the air and then pulled the rug out from under him and dropped him. And he got out and said, yeah, that's pretty fun. And that was kind of the birth of the Vertical Reality ride system.
Yeah, so this will be a real rock and roll, you know, kind of event.
In the same way that we want to work with the best people in every field, we want to work with the best people in music.
The music that we put together is sort of like psycho metal hip hop, just really fast, aggressive beats, and then sort of dark guitars and crazy sound effects.
It's a crazy image. It just seems like game work. To look at the place, to walk in the place and go, oh my God, there are people falling out of the sky.
2018 reveal of a 1998 project 20 years ago, Quake TV, developed by Duke Media. A big thank you to Peter Duke for sharing all of these awesome Quake 2 files, including this map, which was commissioned by none other than Steven Spielberg and GameWorks for a prototype of eSport that could be beautiful enough and replay value would be high enough that people would want to spectate and watch the replays of games and death matches and, I guess, team death matches. But this is QuakeCon 2018, 20 years later, and because of the generosity of Peter Duke, we are getting to play this map tonight with flags on it and probably a lot of players going back and forth. And so it's going to be a beautiful thing. Very excited about it.
Beaver, you excited?
Yeah, I think this antivirus is jacking my thing way up. When I'm playing, man, I'm up around 105.
It's also giving me a Smash Brothers kind of vibe, too.
I can see that.
You mean Mario Brothers? It's a beat 'em up Mario game.
I'm really proud of the work everyone's done to date, and I look forward to get my hands on those joysticks and those little buttons myself because I'm an addicted game addict. I always have been, and that's the reason for my involvement in Sega GameWorks. Well, for me, it's a quick thrill. I mean, you know, it takes me a year to have a quick thrill with a movie. I have I peak a lot during the year, and I have a couple highs. But essentially, it's only when the movie's done that you're able to look at it and say, "Finally, it's over. I'm satisfied." You know, with a video game, I can play that. I can play Tempest, and in 10 minutes, I can probably feel totally like I've accomplished something today. When in fact, I haven't. The machine hasn't paid off. The machine hasn't given me a medal. All the machine does is essentially, you know, massage my ego and say, gee, you've got good reaction time. You can beat me. Now try again.
You want to try that?
Although he's a shrewd businessman, everyone who knows Spielberg says he's still very much like a precocious kid.
There you go.
Even his office is filled with toys, although they're, for the most part, adult toys.
This is the kind of place where potentially we could get no work done.
This grown-up kid has no hesitation telling you he's having more fun now than when he was growing up.
Well, I would have probably hesitated if I had like a couple good years. Then I would have said, well, there was the fourth and fifth grade. No.
What about your popularity? Were you a popular kid?
No. I was, you know, the last kid to be chosen for the softball team, the last kid to be chosen for the touch football team, the last kid to be chosen for basically everything including badminton.
Steven Spielberg's lifelong fascination with gaming continues on through to this day, proving that he really is one of us.
Like all of you here today, I've been playing games for decades, and I even started playing Pong in 1974. And over the years, that experience has exploded from the simple pixels of Pong to worlds that are as immersive as and certainly more physically interactive than those portrayed on the silver screen. And those stories have gotten more compelling as the technology has certainly improved. An amazing opportunity to be at that intersection where technology and myth-making meet to produce something really groundbreaking.
Steven Spielberg.
He saw the future, and then he built it. He gave us a place to go, a place called the Oasis. This is the Oasis. It's a place where the limits of reality are your own imagination. You can do anything. Go anywhere. Like the vacation planet. Surf a 50-foot monster wave in Hawaii. You can ski down the pyramids. You can climb Mount Everest with Batman.
At a tournament in Atlanta more than 20 years ago, Dennis Fong won a Ferrari playing the popular first-person shooter game, Quake. That effectively made him the world's first professional gamer. Fong, better known as Thresh, has since been inducted into the Esports Hall of Fame and has made a career investing in and creating platforms to help build a community around gaming. I spoke to him about the evolution of esports.
These days, you're talking about millions and tens of millions of dollars in prize money, so that's obviously a big difference. you know, also kind of spectator audience size. You know, back when I first started, there were hundreds of spectators at some of the live events. You know, these days you have tens of thousands, you know, live, and millions, sometimes tens of millions. I've heard even north of 100 million for some of the world championships of the big esports. You know, the economics and the way that these sport, quote unquote, esports are approached are slightly different. I mean, it's certainly happening today, but in the past, that was one of the challenges, is the company didn't see why they should invest $100 million into esports. And, you know, certainly they've proven now that making a game an esport can help. It's essentially a free marketing and can drive new players to your game.